In this video, we're going to study second-order systems of linear differential equations and normal modes. So here's a typical system. Instead of giving you the first derivative of x1 and x2 in terms of x1 and x2, the system tells you the second derivative. Since it's a second-order differential equation, the initial conditions have to give you the initial values of x1 and x2 and the initial derivatives of x1 and x2. This might come up from physics, where Newton's law gives you the acceleration, but you have to tell what the initial position and initial velocity are. It can also come up in electrical engineering. There are a lot of systems in the real world described by equations of this type, and the nice thing about them is that the matrices that you come up with almost always are diagonalizable with real eigenvalues. So in this case, we'll look at this matrix, which is diagonalizable with real eigenvalues. So you write our initial conditions in vector form. We write our equation in this form. A dot means a time derivative, so two dots means second derivative with respect to time. Okay, our procedure is exactly the same as with difference equations and first-order differential equations. We diagonalize the matrix. We pick new coordinates, which are the coordinates of x in a basis of eigenvectors. We rewrite our equations in terms of the y-coordinates. We solve one at a time. And then we convert the initial conditions for x into initial conditions for y, into final values of y, into final values of x. So let's do things one step at a time. Our matrix, 1, 3, 2, 2. This is actually the identity plus a matrix we've already seen before. The rows add up to 4, so 4 has to be an eigenvalue, and 1, 1 has to be an eigenvector. Since the trace is 3, the eigenvalues add up to 4, so the other eigenvalue has to be negative 1. And you can work out that the eigenvector is 3, negative 2. Great, we've done part 1. Next, we define y to be the coordinates of x in the B basis. And how is y related to x? By a change of basis matrix. Here's the matrix whose columns are B. So this is PEB. And this is its inverse. So you take a value of x that'll give you a value of y. You give me take a derivative of x and multiply by P inverse, that gives you the derivative of y. Going the other direction, you multiply by P rather than by P inverse. Okay. Now we write out our equations in terms of y. Again, it follows the same general pattern we've seen before. Since x is y1b1 plus y2b2, the second derivative of x is the second derivative of y1 times b1 plus the second derivative of y2 times b2, because b1 and b2 are just fixed vectors. They're 1, 1, and 3, negative 2 for all time. And ax, well, these are eigenvectors, so multiplying the first term by a just gives you the eigenvalue lambda 1, and the second term by a gives you the eigenvalue lambda 2. And the only way for these two things to be equal to each other is if y1 double dot is lambda 1 y1 and y2 double dot is lambda 2 y2. And in this case, the first eigenvalue is 4, the second value is negative 1, and we have our equations, an equation for y1, an equation for y2, and they're decoupled. Then we solve the equations. The equation for y1, well, y1 double dot is a positive number times y1. So we get cosh's and sinh's, and our kappa value is the square root of 4, so that means 2. So we get cosh of 2t and sinh of 2t. Initial value times the cosh plus initial derivative divided by kappa times the sinh. The other equations are negative. Y double dot is minus y2. So the coefficient of negative 1 is less than 0. And our frequency is the square root of minus that, so the square root of 1, which is 1. So we get cosine of 1t and sine of 1t. Initial value times the cosine plus initial velocity divided by omega times the sine. Of course, dividing by 1 doesn't do very much. And now we convert. We take our initial value, and we multiply by P inverse, and we get the initial value for y. We take the initial velocity for x, we multiply by P inverse, and we get the initial value of y dot. And then we can figure out what y1 is. See, y1 of 0 is 3, y1 dot of 0 is 1, so we get 3 times the cosh plus 1 over 2 times the sinh. Initial value times the cosh plus initial derivative over 2 times the sinh. For y2, the initial value is 1, the initial derivative is negative 2, so we get 1 times the cosine minus 2 times the sine. And once we have y1 and y2, we can put them back together to figure out x. X at any given time is y1 times the first eigenvector plus y2 times the second eigenvector. Or if you prefer, you could write this as p times y1, y2. However you slice it, if you know y1 and y2, you know x. And we do know y1 and y2, so there's x. So we wind up with some terms that look like cosh of 2t, terms that look like sinh of 2t, cosine, sine. The cosh and sinh of 2t's have the same value upstairs and downstairs because they're being multiplied by the vector 1, 1. The cosine and sine come in a ratio of 3 parts upstairs to negative 2 downstairs, because they're being multiplied by the eigenvector 3, negative 2. So in other words, our whole picture is we take our initial value and initial derivative, use P inverse to get the initial value and derivative of the y coordinates, solve these things one at a time, then convert back. The only difference between this and the first order difference equation or differential equations is we could write this horizontal step as multiplication by a nice matrix. It was d to the n or e to the dt. Here it's a little bit more subtle. You have to solve the equations and it involves both the initial values and the initial derivatives. But it's still one variable at a time. And that makes it easier. Finally, normal modes. When I say a mode, I mean an eigenvector of A. So in this case, the modes are 1, 1, and 3, negative 2. If the eigenvalue is positive, then something that goes like that eigenvector is going to grow. It's going to have coshes and sinhs, or if you prefer, exponentials. It's going to go as e to the kappa t, where kappa is the square root of the eigenvalue. In this example, it was e to the 2t. If lambda is 0, you get constants plus constant times t. We didn't have any in this example, but you can. And if lambda is 0, then you get oscillations. Things go as sine and cosine. And the frequency of oscillation, actually it's the angular frequency, it's the number of radians per second, is given by the square root of minus the eigenvalue. And finally, here's a physical picture of what could be happening to give us the differential equations we started with. Imagine you have two blocks sitting on top of two hills, and there's a spring connecting them, and right now the spring is relaxed. If you pull them apart, the spring will pull them back together. If you push them together, the spring will push them apart. One mode is x1 is equal to x2, so that means that the two blocks move in lockstep. They both fall down their hills. And they accelerate down their hills because it's going downhill. That's the mode 1, 1. The mode 3, negative 2 has to do with their going apart. And their tendency to fall down the hills is more than overcome by the spring pulling them back up. And if you push them in, the spring pushes them back out. And the matrix isn't symmetric because they weren't the same size block. So this is the kind of system you can understand this motion, you can understand this motion, and an arbitrary motion is a linear combination of something times the first mode plus something times the second mode.